Thank you for listening to Relationship Prescriptions with Dr. Carol.
Welcome once again, friends. It's Dr. Carol, and this is Relationship Prescriptions. I've got something very special that I've been looking forward to sharing with you, and I get to do that today. Have you ever met someone, whether in person or not, and there was just an instant shared understanding? There was just that spark of divine connection, and it was like you had known each other forever. You shared an understanding of the world or of something significant, and it was like you had known each other forever. Well, that's the sense I had the first time I connected with Susie Larson. It's been a couple years ago now, but today I get to share her with you. Susie is a talk show host, national speaker, author of 15 books and many articles. She and her husband, Kevin, have been married since 1985. They have three sons, three daughters-in-law, a grandson, and as she says, an adorable pit bull named Memphis. I have been Susie's guest on her radio program, Midday with Susie, on Faith Radio twice, and it has been an awesome experience. Susie's latest book, Fully Alive, Learning to Flourish in Mind, Body, and Spirit, was the stimulus for me to be able to bring her onto the Relationship Prescriptions podcast and share her with you. I know that this will be encouraging to you. What we're going to talk about in this conversation and what Susie's book is about is dealing with things that don't get better quickly. I know that many of us, many of you who are listening, are dealing with issues that just don't seem to go away. What then? How does God relate to you in those ongoing challenges? The title of Susie's book, Fully Alive, resonated with me so well. As you know, we often say here on the program that God wants us to live fully alive in every area of our lives, and that's why we bring you these programs. Well, Susie's perspective, I know, will be encouraging from a very biblical and faith-filled viewpoint, but also incredibly practical. So without waiting any longer, here is my conversation with Susie Larson. I am so honored, Susie, that you have joined us on the program today. Thank you. It's great to be with you.
Well, Dr. Carol, it's an honor to be with you. It's been fun to have you on the other side of the mic and being able to interview you on your great books, and what an honor to join you in this regard as well.
Well, I have to say, your most recent book of all the 15 that you wrote, you're prolific. The title of your most recent book, Fully Alive, Learning to Flourish in Mind, Body, and Spirit, is just so in line with what we like to talk about on this program and you know, Dr. Kim Industries as a whole. Jesus does want us to live fully alive. And I love that you have brought so much of your personal story to this. And thank you for digging deep into your pockets, as you said, to bring this.
Well, you know, I knew that's probably why you and I connected so heart to heart when I had you on my show the first time. You know, because not everybody thinks this way, but I think the more you discover about the human body, and then the more you read God's word, and the more you apply what he means, you learn how fearfully and wonderfully made we are. I just think it opens up the scripture in a whole new way. So, you know, you're right. This one cost me a lot, but it was worth it. And we're hearing some incredible testimonies.
I can believe that. I can completely believe that. Well, for those of our listeners who may not know much of your story, you are not a stranger to health issues and health issues that go on for some time. Maybe just give us a brief background, a framework of how you come with that part of your story to this topic.
Yeah, okay. You know, I'll give you just a synopsis so you've got a context for where I'm coming from. But I was raised in a large family of seven kids. I was number five. And I was back then just a people pleaser, you know, wanting everybody to be happy. Didn't stand out in really any way. But I remember when I was about 9 years old, coming home from school, I have older brothers and an older sister and two younger sisters. And at that point, my brothers were in a stage of life that wasn't good. They were starting to hang with some pretty creepy friends. And long story short, I was getting something out of the dryer down in the laundry room in the basement. And I heard the door shut behind me, and I turned around to see a number of my brother's friends. No brother was there at that point. He was off somewhere else in the house. And in a matter of moments, those boys had me pinned on the floor. And I won't say more than that. But I got up from that place very traumatized, as you can imagine.
Wow.
And I didn't tell anybody because I was so confused about what had happened. Didn't know if that was my fault or not. And jump ahead, I was about 10 years old, walking home from school, and I saw those wretched bikes out in front again. My mom had had a job, so she needed to work, and so I needed to be home with my brothers before she got home. And I remember saying out loud, which shows you how confused I was as a little girl, but I just said, I don't care if God made me this way, those boys will never touch me again. So I was wandering around the baseball diamond kicking up the dirt, and what I didn't know was in the adjacent baseball diamond, there were another group of teenage boys sitting in the dugout. I think they were probably high on something. When I look back, I remember the crazed look in their eye. They had to have been, for all I heard was, get her. And they ran me down, knocked me to the ground, and they pummeled me and beat me to a pulp. And I was just 4 feet tall as a little girl, and I was curled up in a ball screaming, crying, as they literally punched me in the face, kicked me in the stomach, pulled fistfuls of hair out, and laughed wildly as they did. And I just screamed and cried. And when I got up from that place, and just a side note, I was part of a, my family went to church every weekend, but I was part of a denomination where I knew God was real, but I didn't really know Jesus was accessible.
Yes.
I got up from that place and I heard in my ear, I can get to you anytime, anywhere, and God will never stop me. Mm. And that's when fear got into me, into my cells, into my soul. It got into me. And I was an athlete. I was a decent athlete in high school and junior high school and high school. And when I came to Christ in about eighth grade, and having some decent athletic ability, this is what happens, whatever your giftings are. When you have a lie, when you've picked up a lie, when life has let you down, you will misuse your time, treasure, and talents to try to prove something that Jesus has already proven. And that's just what I did, was spent all of my resources trying to dig myself out of a hole that I believe myself to be in because of those two traumas. And, so when I, jump ahead, I'm a young mom. I married a wonderful Christian guy who was raised in the church, raised as a Christian. And I still was fairly new in my faith. And during our second pregnancy, I was on bed rest for 3 months. During our third pregnancy, I was on bed rest for 6 months. And I was probably 3 months into that pregnancy where the doctors had said, let's let you get up and test the waters. I was getting pretty depressed and feeling like a debt to society, because Dr. Carroll, when you're counting on your own ability to earn your way and suddenly you're put to bed for 6 months and everybody has to accommodate you, it was a nightmare come true on every level for me, because it was confronting all of my insecurities, all of my need for striving. And it was torture. It really just was. And God was trying to get at something deeper for me. But during the one day that I got up, I met some girlfriends from college, my old roommates. And I was careful. We went for a walk. I was 6 months along. By nighttime, I went back to bed because I was contracting again. And within 2 weeks of that outing, my face started to go numb, dizzy spells. My arms went numb. I still had 3 months left to go. And I could not even believe that something else was going on, where I'd been going to my little boys, 5 more months till mommy can make your sandwiches, and
right,
4 more months till mommy can take you to the park. Long story short, I delivered my son 3 weeks early. And my health went downhill, and a year later found out that one day that I was up, I was unknowingly bit by the deer tick and contracted Lyme disease. So that ravaged my health. And when we found out a year later that one day up, that tick attached to me, bit me, dropped off, I never saw it. I hear the lie again, I can get to you anytime, anywhere, and God will never stop me. And that brings me to my current situation. I battled off and on over my last 20 years, really seriously in those early years with health, but I'm a fighter, and I worked in the fitness industry for 15 years, and I love God's word. So I have fought tooth and nail to do everything in my power that I could do to be healthy, to have life, because I felt like God has wanted me to, he's wanted me to fight. I've got things I want to do and things I'm called to, but I had a major relapse 3 years ago. And that's what this book was born out of. And I couldn't believe it. At this age and stage, everything started to go awry in my health again. And I was in my bathroom. I was getting ready to head to the radio station for my show. And I'm begging God, no, no, please, no. And my arms went numb. My face and head went numb. My vision blurred. The room started to spin. I felt like someone put a vise on my head and was just turning it like my head was going to break. And begging God. And the spiritual warfare in that bathroom was so tangible. I'm sure you've been there before, but it was horrific to me. And I felt like the enemy just before, when my face would go numb and I was a young mom, I felt like Satan had me by the face going, you know, where's your God now?
Yes.
And I didn't have an answer for him because I was so new in my faith. Well, this time, because my neck was numbing and my face was numbing, my esophagus was spasming and I couldn't swallow. And so this time I felt like he had me pinned against the wall by the throat. And I thought I was going to die. I thought, this is it. This is it for me. This is how it's going to end for me. And I've heard the little whisper in my spirit. The storms reveal the lies we believe and the truths we need. And I knew it was the Lord. I'm like, in the chaos of these symptoms and the chaos of the warfare, I'm like, what? And I heard it again. The storms reveal the lies we believe and the truths we need. And I'm like, Lord, what lie do I believe? And I heard the enemy rail in my ear. I can get to you anytime, anywhere. God will never stop me. And that just as loud, the Lord thundered back in my spirit and said, Susie, it's not true. You've believed this your whole life. And it is, we don't outrun lies. We turn around and we face them. He said, it is not true that he can get to you anytime, anywhere. You don't know what I've prevented in your life, how I provided. But now it's time. It's time to face this thing down. Yes, it feels like he has you by the throat, but the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet and you will have your foot on his. I'm not going to let you lose, but I have to let you fight. And that began a D-Day battle, not only for my health, but realizing, Dr. Carol, this is when I learned that what happens in your soul happens in your cells. I've been eating right. I've been believing right. I've been standing on scripture. I've been doing everything I know. But there were some lies and traumas in my soul that I had dealt with to a degree. But I believe all of us, if not most of us, have embedded trauma that's not fully resolved, and it will affect our physiology. And you know this as a doctor. And I believe there's times where God knows we're strong enough to finally be delivered, to face it. And he positions us, it's like the enemy is allowed to do this overplayed enemy attack, but it's really for our benefit because God's like, now's the time to win this battle. And that was the case for me. I am not the same person after this battle, and I hated it. But I am not the same person. And this book was really born out of that battle and understanding the integration of mind, body, spirit, and how deeply connected they all are.
Wow. I resonate so much with that story. I think you would probably agree that although you would not want to go back into that battle, you wouldn't give away what you have now become for anything. It's like the devil has tried his best with you and he has lost. You're here.
Amen. I'm still standing and so are you. And that is the thing that I pray to encourage your listeners today is there are times it feels like you will be swallowed alive and to face buried trauma feels like it will take you out. But if God is bringing it up, it's because he's going to bring it out. And I often say this and I don't want it to sound like a cliche because it's not. To me, it's truth that the enemy's threat to you is very connected to your threat to him. You just have to look at your childhood and look at the ways he tried to take you out or tried to take you off at the knees. It's because he saw your potential long before you ever did. And I think God is doing this everywhere in the body of Christ where people feel like God's allowing these attacks on their lives and anxiety and irrational fears are coming up. But I believe what God is doing is saying, no, this is time finally for you to quit treating symptoms and to be delivered so you can be free.
You talk about not just treating symptoms, and the doctor, the medical part of me, thinks that is so important. People often look, whether it's a doctor for a prescription, they look for somebody to fix them, but that goes across all areas. They look for the psychologist or the psychiatrist to tell me one thing that's going to make me okay, or one prayer and God removes this. It's like we want somebody else to instantly fix us. And that's usually not the path God has for us. You talk about the passage in Matthew that starts the way many people will remember it. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Learn of me. And I love the translation that you use. Jesus says, let me teach you. Meaning we can learn. There's some things we can learn in all of this. Unpack that a little bit.
I believe this with all of my heart, that for every believer, there is a next place of promise for us, that not only does God want us to faithfully steward our current assignment, face down our giants in this place, put the enemy under our feet in this place, it's so we can steward this current assignment, but so we can be prepared for the next one as well. So anytime we think we know it all, we've learned it all, we're wrong. We don't know what we don't know. We see as in a glass dimly. We only know in part. And, you know, and I'll give you an example. There was another story, as I referred to in the book and scripture, where the Lord kept bringing me back to the man on the mat who had been there for 38 years. And to be honest with you, I'm a focused, disciplined person. My doctors have said, I don't know anybody who fights like you do. You want this thing, you know? So for God to bring me back to that story again and again, where Jesus asked the man, do you want to be well? And the man's first words were, I can't, sir. My feelings were actually hurt. I'm like, Lord, I don't get why you're bringing me to this place. You know, it hurts my feelings because I'm doing everything I know to do. I'm eating, I'm fasting, I'm taking my meds, I'm doing what I know to do. But he was silent. And I thought, okay, here's something where he has to teach me. There's something I don't know and I don't see. And I said, are there, I can't, that I have embedded in my soul that I don't see. If so, show me what they are. Well, because I was trying to do all the right things, trying to believe all the right things. And I would say, I don't know, it was a couple weeks later, I was at a speaking event, but I was having one of those inflammatory surges, and they're horrible. When they happen, everything goes numb. My brain doesn't work. My face goes numb. My vision blurs. I feel like I want to fall down, and I'm backstage ready to go out and speak. And I'm just begging God for the strength. All I could think about was crawling into bed, but I had a job to do. And as I'm just about to step out, the host grabs me by the arm and pulls me back. And she goes, before you go out there, make sure that you tell them that you struggle with your health. Otherwise, they're just going to hate you when they get a look at you. You're such a cute little thing. And I stopped in my tracks, and it was a light bulb moment because I've heard that 1,000 times. I'd hate you if you didn't struggle so.
Wow.
And I know people mean it in jest, but I'd been shredded by some gossipy women in my early years as a young mom. In fact, I had a book that came out of that called The Uncommon Woman, learning about how to break the stereotype and live out of the love of God and get our identity out of that place. But again, that was a hard fought battle. So subconsciously, when women would tell me, I'd hate you if you didn't struggle so, I didn't know what to do with that. So I stuffed it down a little bit deeper. So here I am backstage, and the Lord whispered to my heart, can you handle it if I heal you? And I realized, Dr. Carol, that was a thing. Like, that would require faith for me. It's like, I didn't even know that was a thing. But I realized I don't want people to hate me. So somewhere deep down inside, there was a part of me that still wasn't contending for healing because there was fear that was pushing that thing down deep. And the Lord whispered to my heart, not everybody's that petty. And those who are hurting too, but I got to have you free. So will you trust me?
Mm.
And I needed to engage my faith. And I said, I trust you. But it was a thing because it required faith. I bet you it was probably 2 weeks later, I was praying, and I pray this almost every day, you know, about asking the Lord to put a firewall between the wicked and the weak and to deliver those caught into human trafficking. And the phrase blessing guilt came to me because, you know, there's 40 million slaves today, more than ever before. And blessing guilt, I'm like, what? And the Lord whispered to my heart, can you handle it if I deliver you and heal you in your currently blessed life when there's 40 million slaves in the world? And I said, no, I didn't have to think about it. So I had a no buried that I wasn't even aware of.
Yes.
And yet I know theologically in my head that what God does for one does not diminish his ability to do for another. I know that. But I had blessing guilt. So there was something holding me back from contending for full healing. And I say all that to say, I believe strongly, as I've interviewed a lot of people on my show and asked this question, I believe there are hindrances to our healing in our own soul. And we've got to be humble and teachable enough to say, this is not a formula. We don't dictate to God. And some he does give a miraculous, instantaneous healing. He does. But for many of us, we need the process because we have so many issues tangled up with our story that God wants to untangle. We got to be a part of the process. And I remember right in the middle of it, when I was begging him to heal me, he said, I could heal you today, but you'd lose it tomorrow because you think like a sick person. And I did, because I was so acquainted with my symptoms more than I was with his promises. And I'm just saying, we've got to be humble enough to say, teach me, Lord. I can't dictate to you. There's not a one size fits all formula. My story is sacred to you. And there are things that I even don't know and don't see about my story. So teach me. And if you come to him humbly, he will teach you. He will show you the lies you picked up when life let you down.
Wow. I mean, I'm being blessed as I listen to that. The stance that you are talking about is not sitting back and accepting that this is as good as it gets, but neither is it saying, if you only have more faith, God's going to heal you. There's some maturity here. There's some growth here. This is a place that Jesus has to teach you to come. It doesn't come without the battle.
Yeah.
Does that resonate?
Oh, so much. And I appreciate you saying that, because there's a lot of heat around the topic of healing. And for the record, I write about this. I either write about it in the book or I tell about it in the companion DVD. I can't remember which place I tell this, but my youngest son was a recipient of a medical miracle. I mean, an instantaneous miracle healing of a serious back injury. So I know God does this miracle stuff. I know it. I've seen it too many times. What I struggle with, and again, I've taken some flack for it, but I'm okay with that, is when you say God heals all the time, instantaneous, no, you know, period. So if a person dies or they don't get their miracle, you were lacking faith. And what I want to say to that is my personal belief, and I pray we can still be friends, whoever's listening, if you would disagree with me, because all of us have to admit that there's mystery and we're not going to know everything to the other side. But what I do believe is that's a cruel theology to stare at someone who's lost someone and say, this wouldn't have happened if you were only lacking faith, is a 30,000 foot view of faith where you are just dictating a formula that just does not apply. There's a mystery. And some people graduate to the next life. They die. I think cancer is from the pit. I hate it. But I know godly people who've gotten sick and died, and they were not lacking faith. And yet, because some have tried and prayed and lost a loved one, they refuse to engage their faith at all. I think it takes so much humility and grit to lean in going, God, I'm going to err on the side of faith. I am asking you for a miracle. I pray I get one in this life, but I know that if I don't in this life, in the next life, I'm going to see that my faith mattered to you. It changed me in the land of the living, and it pleases you for all eternity. So I'm going to lean in, and as long as I have breath. And one of the themes throughout that book, Fully Alive, is to say this: I'm going to pursue healing, and I'm going to pray for a miracle. So I'm going to do what you're asking me to do. Then I'm going to ask you to do it only that you can do. And that's where I land, Dr. Carol. That's where I live, just because I'm not giving up to see, you know, medical miracles that nobody can explain. But I think if you sit on your mat and only wait for that, and you're not willing to change anything, maybe about your diet, your sleep patterns, what you do with your anxious thoughts, I think you may be waiting a long time, because God wants us to partner with him in this process, I believe.
You're talking about something that I believe my listeners will have heard me say before, and that is, when I see myself as cooperating with God, what researchers call collaborative religious coping, scientists can actually demonstrate that we do better that way. When we don't sit back and wait for God to do it all, neither do we see ourselves as the one having to fix it and figure it out. The working together is powerful, and we can demonstrate that scientifically. And you've just illustrated that so well.
No, I'm so grateful. I mean, I've studied this, I've prayed it. And again, you still run into people who are very strong in their opinion, which is okay. And that's why I humbly submit where I've landed. But I just believe there is a mystery to God. And I remember one of my mentors, godly woman, and had throat cancer and had one of those voice boxes, and she was dying, and she would have to push that little machine up to her throat to talk. And she had fire in her eyes. And she said, Susie, she said, this cancer did not come from God. It came from the pit. But she says, make no mistake about it. He does not dictate my days or my life. The Lord Jesus does. And she said, God will take me when he gets more glory from my death than he does from my life. I'm standing in faith, but I'm waiting on the Lord. And I'm like, don't you even tell me that woman was lacking faith. And I want us to be so cautious not to fling that, especially for people who are suffering, because when someone's walked a long time in the valley and you just throw at them, they should have more faith, you're putting a burden on their hearts. They're already trying to deal with it, especially chronic illness. I just think it's unfair to do that without entering into the suffering with them and helping them untangle their story, you know?
That's what Jesus did. He entered into people's suffering, and I don't see him ever blaming someone for not having enough faith as the reason he wouldn't heal them.
Right.
That wasn't the part of that wasn't how Jesus interacted with people. he came with them. And I agree with you. So I'd like to circle back to something that you talked about early on, and I know you reference in the book, and that is these messages of fear that were started so early in trauma that you experienced and that came back, these lies that triggered fear. And you talk about determining to have a zero tolerance policy when it comes to fear. What does that look like for you? How have you walked that out?
Great question. That was a D-Day battle, because fear has been something I've battled my whole life. And I feel like up to this point, this big D-Day battle, it was more like whack-a-mole for me. Like I would try to beat it down and do my next thing. I'd never let fear keep me from taking the risks I felt like God put before me. But I think fear has ruined a lot of my well-being in my life. But this time, you know, I had two doctors working with me, a functional med doctor and a traditional med doctor, both Christians. And would you believe they became good friends through my case? And now they work together to help so many people, which is just an amazing, because those two worlds don't often collide, I would say. But both of them said to me, because the symptoms were so scary. Before we knew what was going on with me, I thought it was a Lyme relapse because it was acting like Lyme, but there were other symptoms that were so concerning that made us all wonder maybe this isn't Lyme. And just for the record, I don't know that I knew what it was by the time I pushed send on that manuscript, so it's not in the book, but this relapse was mold toxicity on my brain. And I had 20 tubes of blood, and an MRI showed 7 areas of atrophy on my brain from severe mold toxicity that attacked my neurology. It was horrific. It was terrible. But before we knew what we were dealing with, fear of the unknown, of debilitating disease, was killing me. And both of my doctors sat me down separately and they said, you've got high inflammation in your body. We're trying to get to the bottom of why. But they said, you can't have fear, because fear opens the door into your physiology to a cascade of inflammatory response. Mm-hmm. And all sickness and disease grows in inflammation. And you've got to create an atmosphere in your body. We've got to lower the inflammation as much as we can so your body can heal. And this is one thing you can do something about. We're trying to work on these other parts, but we can't do this for you. And, you know, and I knew Dr. Carol prior to that there's 365 mentions in scripture about do not fear. I've heard it all, and I've memorized and fasted and prayed. But when I realized I had to fight this thing for the sake of my health and my life, because of what was happening in my neurological system, I went after it. And that's when I realized I had to determine a zero tolerance policy on fear. I had to shut the door, lock it, put a hutch in front of it, paint it, put flowers on it. I mean, I had to just do whatever I could do to go, that thing is not coming in. And then, of course, I studied brain science, and it helped me understand, and you've talked about this before as well, but, you know, our most consistent thoughts form these grooves in our brain. Mm-hmm. And since my most consistent thoughts were towards fear, my body, in trying to help me do the most consistent things I do, formed grooves in my brain for fear, making it easier and quicker for me to get to fear. Well, that becomes a default response. So not only was it opening up inflammation in my body, it was creating these deep grooves in my brain, making it easier and easier to go to fear with the smallest triggers. And what I learned about brain science is you put a road close sign on that pathway, and you just start taking a new pathway. It is hard and it's not instinctive, but in due time, if you don't take that pathway, your brain will delete that neural pathway because you're not using it anymore. And so I literally, with all the strength I could muster in me, just said, I can't afford fear. I don't care if my face and my arms are going numb and the room is spinning. I will not have fear. In fact, I'm going to replace it with faith. And so I just kept saying to my soul, God is good. His promises are true. He will always make a way for me. Lord, conform me to your image. Use this to make me so much like you that the devil will be sorry he ever messed with me. And I had to go there and go there and go there. And it felt like a million times a day, and then 500,000 times a day, and then 100,000 times a day. But over time, I would say after about a month, month and a half, it was a miracle. It was like my instinctive default response when symptoms would flare was faith, because I was retraining my brain. And as a former fitness person, my brain just works that way. When I start to understand the physiological connection to the spiritual life, and you bring those two together, and I understand how the body's working, I'm like, I can cooperate with this process. And it is a miracle to me and this is one of those things, nobody can renew your mind for you. You've got to work with God to do that. And I will tell you, the large share of fear is out of my life. It's not to say that I'm fearless, but there's not close to the evidence that it used to be. I'm not, and especially when symptoms flare, I'm just not afraid, which is a miracle to me. But it was a D-Day fight to the death battle. And as you said at the beginning of the show, I'm so much better for it. I wouldn't trade it for anything.
Yeah. Thank you for saying that it took everything in you, a D-Day battle, as you put it, that it took every ounce of physical, emotional, and spiritual energy that you had, but also that it resulted in a change. Yeah. You're not still stuck there. You're no. different because of that battle. That battle is in your past. Again, not that there's never any symptoms or feelings or holdover, but that battle was one that you fought and won.
Yes. Oh, amen, amen. And one of the things that, I was mostly winning, but there were, when I would have major flares, I would shrink back in fear. And one of my prayer warriors, who I've given full permission to smack me upside the head anytime I need it, she said to me, she said, Susie, you're still trying to defend yourself and trying to get a guarantee on something. And she said, what is it? What is the core of this fear? And this is before we knew what I was dealing with. And I said, further neurological disease, because neurological diseases are so debilitating that I'm such a go-getter in life that I'd rather die than have to live from the sidelines, because Lyme did that for me, for some time. And I'm not saying it's a right thought. I'm just saying it was my thought that it's like, are you going to ask me to go through another debilitating? Am I going to end up in a wheelchair and have to live life? I mean, there was so much fear around it. And she said, well, you got to die to the fear of debilitating disease. I'm like, I cannot. It's so living and so roaring in my face. And she said, Susie, the devil can't attack a corpse. And she said, die. You've got to die.
And I love that.
I love her too. I count on her to say such things to me. And I saw myself like this little rag doll crawling up on the altar going, Lord, I believe you can heal me. I pray that you will. But even if you don't, I'm surrendering my whole life. You are my Lord. And I'm surrendering my whole life to you once again. I'm dying to this fear. And I was curled up in a ball. And I instantly had this vision in my spirit of this lion, like the Aslan from the Chronicles of Narnia, roaring mane, roaring lion, giant, strong, and one paw on one side of me up on the altar, the other paw on the other side of me. And he roars into the atmosphere as to serve the atmosphere. Notice, she belongs to me. And he whispered to my heart, Susie, right now, you feel fragile and vulnerable. But you're only one of those things. You're fragile, but you're not vulnerable. And it was like... it was like the most intimate moment. Just that he would meet me in the worst place of my fear. But again, it was not, he didn't zap me. I had to face down some of those things and go, even if, Lord, that to me, sometimes that takes more faith than anything, you know? But for him to meet me there and for me to sense his protection and protective nature over me was so precious. I'll never forget it.
I can hear you remembering that preciousness. It's touching your soul just to rehearse that. And thank you for sharing that. It reminds me of the three Hebrews and with Nebuchadnezzar in the fiery furnace. And like they said, our God will deliver us, but even if.
Yeah. And you know what's amazing about that story, Dr. Carol, is that that reminds us that when you're in the flames, your story and your trial is not only testing you, it's testing those who are watching you.
Sure.
And the guys, the soldiers who tied them up, what is it, seven times hotter and turned the tighter and the furnace seven times hotter, they actually died while the Hebrew men were dancing around in the fire with Jesus. But I want to say this because the temptation is if someone is struggling where you are weak, that their test is your test. Will you step back and judge and assess and figure out, you know, they must have missed a step? Or will you draw near and go, I can't possibly understand. What's it like in your shoes? What's it like to do a day in your life? We have got to show some compassion and empathy for people who struggle with things that we don't. Because the thing is true is that your journey, my journey, it's sacred to the Lord. And our test is the test for others who are bystanders. And God will deal with those who take on the perspective of a Pharisee. He absolutely will. He disciplines his children. And we've got to walk and approach people suffering with, I think, more humility and even a fear of God.
So true. Susie, as we close, just let me give you an opportunity to speak to somebody who may be wrestling with whether it's chronic illness or some other situation that feels hopeless, and they've prayed and they're not seeing the answer, and they're wrestling with whether it's fear or being disappointed at God and where's my faith, and they feel both fragile and vulnerable. What would you say to them?
That he's coming for you. You know, the Bible says after you've suffered a while, God himself will come, establish you, restore you, and put your feet on solid ground, which means there's an end date to this battle. And I don't believe anybody was born to live and die forever in the valley where it's constant battle. He is good to us, and he allows us to walk through some pretty hard things, but there's another side of the season, and he always, always, if we are trained by that trial, we will come through richer. And there's, I think it's Psalm 126 or 124. I think it's 126. It says, he or she who sows in tears will reap with shouts of joy. They weep as they plant their seed, but they return with a harvest in their arms, shouting joyfully to their God. And I will say that that promise has been fulfilled in my life 100% of the time. And I'm asking you to believe that there's an end date to this battle. Now, the chronic illness thing is so hard, but one of the reasons I wrote this book is because I'm been in there, and today I'm having symptoms. I'm saying this to you to say, as a fellow traveler, don't be more acquainted with your symptoms or your hardship than you are with God's promises, mm-hmm. because I still believe there's an end date, there's another side to this, where you come through stronger, richer in the Lord Jesus, making the enemy sorry he ever messed with you. And there's a difference between surrendering to your circumstances and surrendering to God in your circumstances. To surrender to your circumstances is to be like the man on the mat, to say, this is all there is. You know, this runs in the family, or there's no hope for me. That's surrendering to your circumstances. Surrendering to God in your circumstances is to say, this place doesn't define me. The sickness or this financial hardship does not define me. I'm passing through the valley of the shadow. I am surrendering to God in this circumstance. In other words, I'm going to do what he tells me to do, and I'm going to trust that he's going to do what only he can do. This is not for sissies. We have to engage and keep our hearts in it, and that is hard to do day to day, but your faith is precious to God, and he's searching the world over looking for faith in the hearts of men, and he wants to know, will he find faith in you? He wants faith in you, and if you could trust him, it may not look like you think it will, but he is a breakthrough God, and he's not going to let you suffer just for the sake of suffering. He's not going to waste your time in the valley. He's going to redeem and restore you. So get a vision for what that looks like so you can keep walking and see kind of hope on the horizon.
Thank you for sharing your story, Susie, and especially for illustrating that nothing need be wasted. I appreciate that your journey is not being wasted, and I know our listeners too appreciate that. We'll make sure the show notes to your book and all the social media and everything are in the show notes for this podcast. But a great big huge thank you, and God bless you for being with us today.
Well, you are a dear sister, Carol. Thank you so much.
Wasn't that encouraging? I'm sure there was something in that conversation where some point where you said, yes, I felt that, I've wondered that, I struggled with that. Well, I know that this conversation has given you some perspective. I encourage you to listen to Susie on her program on Faith Radio. We'll make sure that link is in the show notes. And then get her book, Fully Alive, Learning to Flourish in Mind, Body, and Spirit. That link will also be in the show notes, as well as ways you can connect with Susie Larson on her website or social media. The practical steps to flourishing in every way that God allows is so powerful. But even more than that, that prayer that says, God, I know you can do this, and I'm going to bring everything I have to working together with you to experience the goodness that you want to bring. But even more, regardless of what happens, I'm with you. I still trust you. Even if, regardless, I'm still with you. That's the solidness with which God relates to us and with which we can trust him. Thank you so much for joining me. I want to remind you that our online community, the Fully Alive Group, is open, and I would so love you to join me as a member in the Fully Alive group. The kinds of questions that Susie and I talked about, where you're wrestling with some of those very challenging things. What does God say about this? What does God say about fear? And how can I walk out getting out of fear? That's the kind of support that we can offer inside the Fully Alive group. Or whether it's other things, some of those lifestyle practical things, and Susie even mentioned those, you know, being physically active, watching your diet, getting appropriate medical care. How do you bring all those together? We talk about that in the Fully Alive group. And wonderfully, inside the Fully Alive group, you get an increased level of personal connection with me, coaching options and ways to interact with me live and question and answers, and just that personal kind of support and connection from me, Dr. Carol, individually, and also from other group members. So check out fullyalivegroup.com. I would love to have you connect with us there. If you have a question on this topic or a comment about the podcast in any way, I'd love to hear from you. And it would also be wonderful if you would comment or share the podcast with others, comment on iTunes, rate the program. It does help others find out about it. Until next time, may God bless you.